Hello, I'm Marcia Cavanaugh. Thanks so much for joining us. Well, so far in the presidential campaigning, we have been hearing about New Hampshire and Iowa. But where does Louisiana fit in? We'll look tonight at the Louisiana primary and how it is defying other southern states. On the crime beat, a shortage of police means an increase in response times, and we'll look at what's being done about it. And there could be a new trial in the Danziger police shooting case. Elsewhere, we will examine some special learning opportunities for Louisiana students, and our Future Watch segment probes what's big and what is new in the fall's convention and event calendar. On the calendar for us are tonight's Informed Sources. Errol Laborde, producer of Informed Sources. Mike Pearlstein, investigative reporter, WWL TV Channel 4. Don Ostrom, Channel 12's Future Watch reporter. And Paula Pendarvis, producer of the WYS Channel 12 special American graduate Louisiana Opportunities. We're going to go first over to Mike first. With the police response story you did yesterday, and then last night there was a robbery at an uptown restaurant that really just sort of points out what your story was all about.
Yeah, exactly right. Now, we know that the police department is at a modern-day low in the number of officers, under 1,150 officers. But the way that this manifests itself out on the street is that it's taking longer to get to routine calls. And if a bunch of calls come in at once, those calls form a backlog. And what we found by obtaining these internal memos from police commanders was that officers who start a platoon on the night shift sometimes inherit backlogs of 20, 30, even 40 calls that are waiting. And we found some victims who, in the case of code ones, which are the least serious calls, usually nonviolent property crimes, they can be waiting for hours. We found one victim of a minor battery who waited all night and then into the next day, 17 total hours waiting for a police response. And, you know, even the police chief confronted that head on, saying, well, this is unacceptable, and it's a result, obviously, of, you know, the lack of manpower. Now, the remedies so far have been, minor at best. They moved a few officers out of desk jobs to put them on the street. There was a ordinance to decrease the number of false burglar alarms by penalizing property owners after the second false alarm. What the chief unveiled to us in sort of an exclusive sneak preview of coming attractions is a new system that he's hoping to get online by the end of this year, online crime reporting, which in the case of nonviolent property offenses, somebody can just go straight to their computer and report the crime that way. No need to call for police, to have a police officer come to the scene and tie up an officer who could be responding to calls on the street.
Well, last night, and I referred to this, there was a robbery at the restaurant Patois uptown.
Right.
And from what I've read, the owner is claiming it took about 30 minutes for police officers.
Yeah, we actually went and checked the log of that. It actually took 17 minutes from the time police were called to the actual response on the scene. Well, if you are the victim of a crime, and especially, you know, a serious crime like an armed robbery, every minute seems like an eternity. So I'm sure it seemed like very long. And 17 minutes is too long to wait in that kind of a crime, simply because if police are able to get on that scene quick enough, they can block a possible escape route, spot a car, maybe make apprehensions on the scene. 17 minutes, and this was now calling 911 after the robbers had left the restaurant. It's going to be too long. They've made their escape.
Do you think the robbers and everybody else knows this, and that's why they're getting more
brazen? Let me tell you, they don't know it necessarily by, you know, looking at the records or maybe watching my report on TV, but they know it on the street just by, you know, the visibility of cops, the, you know, how slow they are to respond to these kinds of scenes. So I think the word is out on the street. In the case of, you know, Patois, the police chief who we caught up with today admitted that, you know, this is unacceptable, but in the case of the robbery uptown, police officers were already on the scene of other robberies. And that was one of the sort of critical findings in my story, which was that not all of the calls that are waiting for hours and even into the next day are these, you know, minor non-emergencies. Mm-hmm. Some are what they call code twos, lights and sirens, person in danger, person hurt, possible crime in progress. When you can't respond to those, it's a problem that needs to be addressed.
Is this something that folks in Orleans or anybody who is in Orleans and has to report a crime should expect? Is a long police response time?
I think, you know, the word's starting to get out, and you know, the most common, I guess, type of incident that officers respond to is a car accident. And people now realize, wow, if you get an accident, you are going to be tied up for hours just waiting for an accident investigator to get on the scene. And it's such a hassle. It's far more serious in the case of a crime scene. I talked to a person who was a victim of a burglary at an apartment. Police did not respond that day. They were told her to don't touch anything, preserve the scene, but she's told me, hey, I have kids, we have to, you know, resume our life and continue on. In fact, before police ever got there, she actually ended up, out of fear, moving from the apartment, and it ended up not even being recorded as a crime simply because they left and didn't follow up on the report.
Bottom line, we need more police.
More police, but in the meantime, it's measures like the police chief hopes, online police reporting that can alleviate things in the meantime.
All right, Mike, thanks a lot. We're going to go over to Paula right now and talk about education. Paula and I and our colleague Tom Gregory just finished a special half hour called American Graduate Louisiana Opportunities, and we took a look at education, public education. It's sort of a broad sampling of what's happened in the 10 years since Katrina. So taking a look at Orleans Parish, particularly in public education, what'd you find?
Well, by every measure, there have been achievements in academic performance. By every measure. In the school year right before Katrina, when it ended in May of 05, only 35% of the students in Orleans Parish were proficient on their test scores. And then now, the last statistics we have are 2013, 2014, it's 62%. That is a leap of 27 percentage points. The state was always way, way, way above Orleans Parish in terms of that proficiency. The gap has closed from 23 points behind before Katrina to now just 6 points. So, and one of the other key figures is the African American test proficiency rate was only 32% prior to Katrina. Now we're at 59%, higher than the state average.
Of course, one thing that we know, RSD took over a lot of the failing schools, and the RSD was set up before Katrina hit. After Katrina, it gave the RSD a chance to move in, take over failing schools. There are a lot of changes now in the RSD. They're really all charter schools. There are some schools still under the Orleans Parish School Board. We are seeing, we talked to John White, who is the superintendent of education for the state. Certainly we are seeing graduation rates in the state increase, and also in Orleans Parish. ACT scores are going up. And basically, I think what we found, though, is while there is progress, there's still a lot more that needs to be done. And there's frustration with parents that we discovered also in Orleans Parish.
Yeah. The thing is that now parents have a choice to send their kids to a better school, but the problem is there's not enough choices. Only 8 of the 82 schools in Orleans Parish, I'm talking about all of them, RSD, Bessie, the Orleans Parish School Board, only 8 have a letter grade of A.
Only 25. RSD is the Recovery School District.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But only 25% of those 82 schools are A or B.
Yeah.
So as a parent, how do you choose between a C or a D school for your kids?
And that's what we're hearing from the parents is, you know, the A school, maybe their kid got into an A school through the one app, and that's another issue, but it seems to sort of be resolved. But their kid may get into an A school, but it's across town. The school is across town, and not all parents can get their child
across
town.
Heard of families, too, where one kid gets into the A school and the second kid gets into a different, and parents can't do that either.
No, they
can't. Get all their kids in the same place.
It's not a user-friendly thing, but the education leaders realize that those parents are their clients, their consumers, and they're trying. So, yeah, the test scores show that major progress has been made, but until every kid in New Orleans can go to an A school, there's a lot more to do.
And there's still supply and demand, right? The demand for the highest achieving schools is still great. You know, there are fewer spots and more students who end up maybe qualifying but not able to attend.
Yeah, there's a lottery. You know, it's just so difficult to get into a Lusher or a Baby Bent. It's just nearly impossible.
Progress made, but a lot more to be done. We also touched on a couple of other things, like the St. Bernard Parish School System. Doris Voce, the superintendent there, stood up that school system in November of 2005. She got her kids back in some fashion. But then also there's opportunities out there, focusing on what's called opportunity youth, young people 16 to 24 who aren't in school, don't have jobs. And you, just quickly, if you can just kind of describe a program at Tulane Cowan Institute.
I wanted to first point out the reason why they call these kids opportunity youth is because of the opportunity they represent to get them to become members of society and taxpayers instead of using tax dollars to support them. But Tulane University is very active through the Cowan Institute in trying to find futures for these kids. What's really scary is in Louisiana, 55% of them actually graduated from high school. So it's not just dropouts. Mm-hmm. So what they're doing is, there's a program called Earn and Learn. You'll see it in the show that we did. It takes these kids, pays them to do apprenticeships at Tulane, either working in construction, carpentry, the IT department, the sports department, the athletics department. They also get free tuition to the Louisiana community and technical colleges. Mm-hmm. And when they finish their year-long internship, ideally they'll find a job. This year's first crop of apprentices amazingly, overwhelmingly found jobs. It was so successful, they're doubling the number of apprentices that will start in a month. But the reason why these kids need training is you can teach them how to weld, you can teach them how to build something, but kids today are not learning the soft skills. They don't know. You have to show up on time. You have to get along with people.
So that's all part of it as well. Yes. And as Paula said, this piece is in American Graduate Louisiana Opportunities. It premiered actually last night, but it will show again this Sunday, again next Thursday, then on Thursday, September 3rd, Friday, September 4th. You see the times there. Thanks a lot, Paula.
Thank you.
All righty. We're going to go on over now to Errol and Louisiana Primary.
You know, when the framers of the Constitution, when they created the Constitution, it was in many ways a brilliant document, and they created the presidency, which has certainly been a process that's worked. The one thing they didn't figure out is how you go about the process of getting candidates to run for the presidency. There's no mention of the word political parties at all. So what we have is a process that evolved, and even within the parties, all these years later, they still haven't figured out for sure how to select the nominee of the party. So every 4 years, we see new things being experimented with. And this year, we have something called the SEC primary, which is taken from the Southeastern Conference. It's a group of southern states that got together. It was the Secretary of State of Georgia who figured this out. He says, why don't we have all the southern states run together on March 1st, and that way, they'll get more attention. All the candidates will come. But also, all these states tend to be more conservative. And you're really talking about the Republicans here, because that's where the issue is. And so conservatives can make their pitch early in the campaign process. And candidates will have to address conservative issues. So some of the states, Georgia and Tennessee and a few others, are in it, and a few non-SEC states are in it also. So that's Tuesday, March 1st. Louisiana has refused it. Louisiana and a few other states wanted to have its own primary. Louisiana's will be Saturday, March 5th, which is, first of all, consistent with the Louisiana tradition of having state elections on Saturdays. But the argument out of Louisiana was, yeah, but we're going to be lost in there. We're not going to get enough attention. And so if you have the SEC primary that Tuesday, then maybe that Saturday we'll get a lot more attention. And in fact, it will be the only primary in the nation that day. There will be a few caucuses around the country. And so Louisiana could conceivably get more attention depending what happens in the SEC primary. And it's going to be proportional, and you know, the vote. So if Trump gets 30% of the vote, he'll get 30% of the delegates. Curious about this is what happens to Bobby Jindal. I would think that the primary system goes like from January until June, so it's a long process. And so it's still early to process. If Jindal's still in the campaign at this time, I don't think it's any essential he's going to do well in Louisiana, especially if he's still at the bottom of the polls, because people in Louisiana said, well, why waste our vote? And so it could be that, you know, Donald Trump will be gentle in Louisiana, but it's going to be a different kind of politics and something new.
And still a long way to go. Like you said, it starts, what, January? The primaries start in January to June.
Yeah, but the whole presidential election has advanced. I mean, it used to be that when you had the New Hampshire primary in the election year, that's when people started talking about the mm-hmm. presidential thing. Now they're talking about the year before. There's already been debates.
Right.
And I think that's because of cable TV. I think cable TV has got so much time to fill, so many talking heads, it's created so many events, and so it's actually advanced the process a year, where in Louisiana, to me, it's drawing attention for the governor's election. Yeah, so.
Okay, March 5th for Louisiana primary.
Then. March 5th.
Okay, thanks, Errol. Back over to Mike, and the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals upheld a district court ruling for the Danziger bridge case, new trial.
Right, and the operative word here is it could be a new trial, mm-hmm. depending on whether there's an appeal of that 2-1 Fifth Circuit ruling. The appeal would go to the full panel of the Fifth Circuit. It would seem unlikely that the Fifth Circuit would step in to overturn a ruling. We don't even know, the U.S. Attorney's Office, Ken Polite's office, has not indicated if they plan on that appeal. So the likelihood is that there will be either a retrial or the opportunity to now plea bargain. Some of these officers received very lengthy sentences.
And there are five officers involved
five
here.
Convicted.
Four are in prison right now.
Correct. So the four in prison were the ones who were actually on the bridge who did the shooting, which, remember, it cost the lives of two people, wounded four others. The fifth is Archie Kaufman. He's out on bond. He was alleged to be part of the cover-up and actually the engineer of the cover-up after the fact.
And to remind people, the case, it was the lower court, the district court, Judge Engelhardt, right?
That's Kurt Engelhardt.
Granted a new trial because of the prosecution online scandal.
Right. Well, that was,
commenting.
Of course, involved, you know, Jan Mand, who was the first assistant, Sal Perricone. It was also instrumental in the case, making online comments on NOLA.com, dozens and hundreds of online comments, which were found by Judge Engelhardt to be prejudicial. Now, it was somewhat of a controversial ruling. You know, the same argument was used by other people who had been convicted, including Aaron Broussard and Ray Nagin, saying that the online comments about them, you know, prejudice their trials. Well, other federal judges saw that there was not enough prejudice to affect the outcome of their cases. And that was, you know, supposed to be one of the tests in overturning a jury verdict, which is difficult to do. The legal bar is high. And one of those elements is, you know, would the outcome have been different mm-hmm. If not for this prosecutorial misconduct? Well, Engelhardt found that it was just so much misconduct that they deserved a new trial, and it looks like they're on track to get that.
And so also, aside from the online comments, also the judge, was it Judge Engelhardt, was also questioning the investigation done by the Department of Justice too, the DOJ?
Right. I think, you know, if there was any straw that broke the camel's back, one of the Department of Justice attorneys who was brought in to help with the prosecution, and remember all this was done in conjunction with the Civil Rights Division in Washington, that person was also commenting online. So it ended up being two of the local prosecutors, one prosecutor from BC, really muddying the waters of this case. Given how costly the trial was, how lengthy, and how it opened up all of the Katrina wounds, and then you really have to think about, you know, the families of the victims. Mm-hmm. If they have to then go through another trial on this, it's just an ordeal.
So we're just awaiting word now from U.S. attorneys to see what the next step would be.
That's right. I mean, if they indicate that they're not going to appeal, then that's going to be set on the calendar for motions and mm-hmm. a trial.
Are all the key witnesses still around?
Well, the most important of the key witnesses would be the police officers who cut deals, pleaded, and testified against their fellow officers. I believe completed sentences and are out and available to, once again, provide the same testimony, which was very damaging testimony. However,
it gets so far removed from the actual time, it gets hard to.
We are more, you know, 10 years
removed.
Are
they likely to, you know, change that testimony? They would perjure themselves.
Well, that
if
is highly unlikely. But the advantage that a defense attorney has is he knows the playbook now and knows what to expect in a retrial.
Okay, Mike, thanks a lot. We're going to go to Dawn now. And so what's happened at our convention center?
Well, usually in the fall, the last couple of falls, we have had record crowds, huge shows, the American Academy of Ophthalmology, the cardiologists have come in. This year, there are none of those huge, big conventions coming in. The next one, really big coming in, ophthalmology is coming back in 2017. They book 5 years out. But the convention center has what they call, they used a baseball analogy. They said, you know, we're not getting triples and home runs, we're getting singles and doubles. And those singles and doubles still score runs eventually. There are about 11 big meetings coming in between now and the end of the year. The Honda Dealers of America are meeting, that's 5,000 people coming in. The American Health Information Management Association coming in, bringing 6,000 people. The biggest thing coming in besides Bayou Classic is the International Workboat Show, which is now in its 36th year coming to New Orleans. So the bread and butter business is definitely back. More visitors came through our airport last year than before Katrina. Those numbers are back up. The convention center says more than 1.2 million meeting attendees came to the city last year. And those meeting attendees bring their family members and they visit restaurants. So we have to hope that the crime problem gets fixed because when you can't go to a restaurant like Patois and feel safe, that causes problems for this business too. But there are new things coming around too. In the spring, there's a show coming in called Collision. It's the sister convention to a group called Web Summit, which is a European-based convention. It's the biggest tech conference in Europe. It's happened the last 2 years in Las Vegas. It's now moving to New Orleans. It had 7,500 attendees from 89 different countries last year. And also among the attendees were 450 leading technology investors. So when you look at New Orleans and say it's becoming a tech city, becoming a city for entrepreneurs, when you get 450 of the biggest investors in tech and startup coming in, it could be huge for business. So it's something they're really looking to grow on after 2 years in Vegas having it come here. That's not until the end of April. So between now and then, there are a lot of these smaller meetings, but they say these smaller meetings are really, they're actually better for business because they don't take the huge setup and the huge teardown and cause so much construction, not construction, but traffic and problems in between. You just keep rolling and rolling and rolling. For instance, in September and October, there are six, back to back to back, 6,000 attendees, 8,000 attendees, just keep going.
This convention business is just so crucial and so critical to the overall tourism industry and the success of it here.
It is. And, you know, 18,000 people coming actually at the end of the year for the American Society of Health Systems Pharmacists. So just different groups. They plan, these big groups plan 5 years out. So it's hard to know, you know, it's kind of like bidding on a Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. You win some, you lose some. The big ones do keep coming, but the small ones are really what keep the pot full.
So are we basically at the level of where we were?
A little bit better than pre-Katrina.
A little bit better, even better.
You know, when you get like a Super Bowl, it's wonderful, but the cost of getting the Super Bowl in, you know, what the community has to put up.
Right, and the cost of bidding on these big conventions and then what you have to do to keep them here and putting up the banners for them and rolling out the welcome mats. The 6,000 people meetings don't require that kind of cost and effort going in, and they bring in all the people to the city.
Okay, well, we'll be looking for these visitors. Thanks, Dawn. I'm going to go back over to Mike now. And, of course, we're going into this week now, 10th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina. WWL last night had a retrospective on of the reporting that was done for 10 days of Katrina. It was a very, very powerful piece. While you're here, we want to get, you know, your memory. You were at the Time-Speaker unit that time. What was it
like for you? That's right. And, you know, I had covered hurricanes before and traveled to get to the eye of the storm. This was different for a variety of reasons. One is that it was, you know, hitting my hometown, and I had sent my family packing on the road that Sunday. And then immediately when the levees broke and the city filled with water, the reporting turned rather chaotic, you know, just getting around with, and of course, no electricity. How are we going to get our stories out? And with all the reporters who remained in the city, there was the issue of our own homes going underwater, being damaged. In the case of my family, it was, I think, 3 days before I got any word on where they had gone. It turns out they were high and dry in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. But you know, being out of touch from your family, seeing the water rise on your house, but all the while having to keep your eye on the ball and you know continue to report. In a lot of cases, you know, those were some 18-hour days early on. The one thing that struck me right away was when we went to one of our first stories was at the Walmart on Chapultepec, which was dry, and we had heard they were, you know, there was an orderly dispersal of water and necessities by police. Well, we got there, and we didn't see that at all. We saw wall-to-wall looting, and even more alarming was the fact that police officers were also looting. They weren't controlling this, and it was, you know, almost a lawless environment. And that was a very unnerving. And it made us realize, however, now, you know, we certainly, it was in some ways, you know, even more, you know, important to cover this, to let the world know what was going on here. At the same time, it was, you know, a little alarming to be in that environment.
When were you finally able to join up with your family?
Well, it was about 9 days. I remember driving to Baton Rouge and getting a flight, but you know my head was so in New Orleans and in Katrina and the reporting on it. As soon as I got to Milwaukee, I went straight to the shelter in Milwaukee, where I you know covered evacuees in a big shelter up in Milwaukee, and you know just incredibly enough, all the sort of interconnections you find in these kinds of stories. I had witnessed a murder and a murder scene that got abandoned because the storm hit. And I found a witness to that murder up in the shelter in Milwaukee. And I reported on that. And I got to tell you, as great as it was to see my family, hug, kiss, have a nice dinner, sleep in a, you know, in a bed, I couldn't wait to get back. That was where the story and the action was at the time.
What a story to cover. Let's hope that you never have another one like that to cover
again.
That's for sure. Okay, time to look ahead right now. Errol.
We actually looked at today with some sad news. Beauregard Bassett, who a lot of people know, died this morning. He was very, very active in Carnival in many ways, served as the chairman of the city's Mardi Gras committee for many years, and really behind the scenes dealt with a lot of the issues and problems of Carnival. But he also served from, I think, 88 to 2001 as the executive director of City Park, pulling in a salary of $1 a year. Mm-hmm. This is a time when the park was in hit some dire financial problems, and he got involved. He rebuilt the carousel, rebuilt the casino building, and really had a real passion for the park. And so he was a man who was beloved in many ways.
And we give him a lot of thanks for everything he did for the city. All right, thanks, Errol. Mike.
We're just looking ahead to this, what's going to be a week of Katrina commemorations, events. For those who want to, you know, get out, there will be no shortage of that. There will be some major events that involve, you know, two former presidents, Bill Clinton and George W. Bush, coming to town, as well as the sitting president, Barack Obama.
Right.
For those who just want to watch from the comfort of their couch, WWL-TV will be airing specials every night after the regular broadcast at 6:30.
Okay, Mike, thank you. Don?
More on the same note, I had the opportunity this week to see the premiere of Robin Roberts' documentary on Katrina. It's called Katrina 10 Years After the Storm. It airs this Sunday night on ABC at 9 o'clock. It's a really well thought out piece that covers really New Orleans all the way through the Gulf Coast.
Okay.
And with some happy, good stories in it,
all
too.
All right, Don, thanks. Paula.
And to, again, look at how education has changed in New Orleans since Katrina, go to WYES.org, go to the American Graduate website, and you'll see the webcast of that parent perspective meeting and really hear what parents are going through right now. It's very interesting.
Right. Thanks, Paula. Thank you guys for being here. Thank you all for watching, and we want to see you again next week for Informed Sources. Have a good evening.